going to be about Bitcoin. And if I could have my next two speakers come out, Keith Raboy and Barry Silbert. Barry Silbert, who's the CEO and founder of Second Market, and now is also starting a Bitcoin company. And Keith, who is a partner at Coastal Ventures and has a long history in payments, was most recently CEO of Square and was one of the key executives at PayPal. So thank you very much for both coming here. And why don't we get started? I actually have something for you, Keith, that I've got to go get. But why don't we just start?
No present for me. I don't get it.
I will get you a present.
You have to earn the present.
Great.
But it's. I think you'll. Well, you guys can fight over it. Bitcoin.
Dogecoin.
Bitcoin has been in the news a lot. There's been a crash. You know, one of the biggest exchanges just turned out. You know, wasn't very secure and lost $400 million worth of customers' accounts. China decided they don't like it. There's all sorts of new tax rules, and the price is very volatile. Last time I checked, it was at like 436. I think we have a chart we can put up here. So it's, oh, now it's 448. Okay, I should have bought.
Right.
But is Bitcoin real money today? And if not, what will it take to get there?
Can I kick it off with the audience question? I always do this when I speak. So some audience participation. So on the spectrum of Bitcoin skeptic to Bitcoin believer, by a show of hands, who would call yourself a Bitcoin skeptic? Ooh, tough crowd. OK. And then who's a Bitcoin believer? OK, probably about maybe 10, 15% believers and 60, 70% skeptics. And the rest, you just have no idea what I'm talking about, pretty much? Yeah, OK.
Yeah, I have a t-shirt for you. I've discovered it's not just Newsweek that gets scoops.
That's great.
So how many believers do we have in the audience?
It's a few.
Basically about two-thirds.
About two-thirds.
No, skeptics, we're two-thirds.
Yeah. Where
would sorry.
Where would you put yourself?
I'm so used to Silicon Valley.
Right.
Where are you?
Oh, I'm a believer. Yeah.
Neutral leaning skeptic.
Okay, so let's start with the skepticism. Why are you skeptical?
Well, so I think generally speaking in payments, it's not that difficult to build an improved, well-designed product compared to the financial services industry. That's actually really easy. Half the people down the street, if you just walk through SoMa, could build a better product than people use every day to transact. The hard part about payments and financial services is to build a better, elegant product that complies with various laws and regulations and is secure and eliminates fraud. So it's the design constraints of regulation that actually impose the difficulty, and that's why you see innovation in payments and financial services so rarely, and so why it rarely like gets lit. So what's yet unclear to me is if you take away the regulatory arbitrage, which Bitcoin is currently taking advantage of, is there anything that sort of distills as a substrate that's serious as a value proposition? And that's completely unproven. And we'll find out. I mean, it's interesting, a decade, 14 years ago, we had this company called PayPal, and the original tagline was the new world currency. In fact, I still have a t-shirt. That's what I actually thought you were gonna bring out, was one of our old PayPal t-shirts that said the new world currency, because we had this dream of liberating the world from the tyranny of governments and allowing for transactions to flow freely across borders, to people to protect their wealth and resources, and insulate themselves from the fiat of governments and bureaucrats. And we hit reality, sort of steered to a slightly more traditional transactional scheme, and never really achieved that vision. And then it's interesting to see, like 14 years later, something that's close to that vision starting to take off. And the question is whether these fetters and filters and bureaucrats will re-steer Bitcoin into a banal, sort of commonplace instrument as well.
So Barry, do you think that Bitcoin's gonna fulfill the original PayPal mission?
Yeah, well, I think there's a good chance. And you know, Keith is one of the most successful investors and operators, certainly of recent time. So you gotta be crazy to bet against him. But I would say that I think Bitcoin has the potential to radically transform the financial system, the payment space or remittance space. And it really does combine this concept of digital currency with this payment network infrastructure. And so while I absolutely agree with Keith that kind of the regulatory risk certainly exists, over the past year, 2 years, as I've been involved in Bitcoin, I spent a lot of time with the regulators, policymakers, I think what you would learn from them is once they kind of dug in and came to appreciate what Bitcoin was, they either came to the conclusion they can't stop it, so they're going to try to kind of put it in the guardrails, as they say, or they actually see the benefits of providing banking services to underbanked. They see the benefit of taking some power away from the big banks. And from a policymaking perspective, it's actually been a fairly, I think, supportive and well-balanced approach to Bitcoin regulation. So FinCEN has come out saying it's legal. The SEC is not going to regulate. CFTC is not going to regulate. IRS came out with guidance. Now, look, they can all and probably will all change their minds, but at least here in the U.S., it's actually a fairly friendly environment right now.
But so let's get back to sort of basic principles. Like, what is, maybe just to start from first, we're sort of assuming everyone understands what Bitcoin is. Can you define what is Bitcoin and what makes it different from other currencies?
Well, so I always kind of look at it in the two separate buckets. You have Bitcoin as this digital currency, like store of value, unit accounts, and then you have Bitcoin, this transactional network that can move money around the world peer-to-peer without having to rely upon a trusted intermediary. And that's the real innovation. All the press, all the debate, all the headlines are about Bitcoin price and volatility. And it is interesting, and I don't think you can kind of bifurcate the two. I think that they're actually, you know, very closely intertwined. I believe that Bitcoin has the potential to be kind of gold version 2.0 for our generation. I believe it has the potential to serve as a currency in countries like Argentina and Thailand, who tend to destroy their currencies every 10 or 20 or 30 years. But the real innovation is this payment network, this remittance platform, that if it is successful, you know, Goldman Sachs came out with a report a couple weeks ago that said it can eliminate $200 billion a year in additional costs that's in the system.
So the transactional platform is real, and there's significant pieces of innovation that come together, actually, a very comprehensive, thoughtful reinvention of a transactional platform. I always joke with friends when they call me up and say, you know, which payment platform should I use? I always answer that question with, well, what decade do you prefer? And I mean the 60s, 70s, or 80s, because all transactional platforms that exist, at least in the United States, and basically, in the United States, were built in those decades, and no one's really built a new one since. And so there's a lot of legacy issues associated with all of those, and this is the first kind of modern reinvention, and it could be used for a lot of very positive purposes. I'm not sure if they're inextricably linked, the currency to the platform. I actually think also people will take the primitives underlying the platform and apply them to non-financial services objectives. So you're going to see various versions of this innovation appear in other places, and I think that's fascinating, independent of Bitcoin, qua Bitcoin.
But when we talk about money, all right, there's two things that I think about. I think of it as, you know, a way to exchange value, right, and also a way to store value. And I think that definitely people are using Bitcoin to exchange value. And most times when you actually buy something with Bitcoin, you exchange it immediately for a currency because of the volatility, right? So it hasn't yet proven to be a store of value, except for, you know, people who are sitting on it, right?
Right. Well, look, if you bought it 2-3 years ago, it's been a fantastic store of value. If you bought it for the past 3 months, you're probably kicking yourself. But you got to keep in mind that this whole thing is—it's so nascent. It's really just taking off right now, and the volatility absolutely does not help merchant and consumer adoption. But you're actually starting to see the businesses address that issue. Like, for example, the payment processors, Coinbase and BitPay, they both guarantee conversion rates to merchants that accept Bitcoin. So essentially, the merchants are not taking any of that volatility risk. And then the next version of wallets that will be coming out, the wallets themselves will enable you to kind of hold fiat currency. And when you want to kind of go buy something in overstock and get a 2% discount because you're using Bitcoin, it'll do the immediate simultaneous transaction, dollars to Bitcoin, Bitcoin to overstock, and you get your towels.
But is it the peer-to-peer, no central bank involved aspect of it that's so revolutionary? Or is it the underlying technology, the blockchain, which is the ledger, right, that allows these transactions to occur and them to be recorded in the internet, essentially?
I'd argue both, because, for example, in the first category of not having a central authority, it allows you to take away some of the costs. So when you have a central authority, you have to actually pay for that. And basically, if there's a monopoly on that central authority, you pay a lot. You pay this huge premium. Like, just look at investment banking fees, because you have to have an investment banker to go public. You pay like an absurd amount for no risk. So that's similarly true in the financial services world. On the underlying sort of exchange, I actually think of it as the first API that allows someone to write code to move money. It's actually shocking, but like basically you cannot write code that moves money or assets from point A to point B, at least in the United States. There's other people trying a more traditional approach, like companies like Standard Treasury, but none of the major banks in the United States has an accessible API that allows a programmer to innovate on top of a platform. And so this is a great replacement for the whole platform that allows anybody to write code that moves money from point A to point B.
And you know, I mean, the real innovation, you know, that Keith is referencing is, you know, we have this existing financial system that was built over decades of like old rails. You know, systems that don't talk to each other, you know, country to country that don't talk to each other. You know, what Bitcoin and all these kind of cryptocurrency, digital currency platforms provide is the elimination of the kind of the independent, trusted intermediary. So if you can eliminate the need to rely upon anybody and you can have a peer-to-peer node system, it enables the movement of really lots of different types of value. And there's talk about smart contracts, and it's in a very, very exciting space. But I think, you know, for Bitcoin, I think it has the potential to radically transform this entire system, but the outcome is likely binary. It's either going to change the world and, you know, as I guess Mark Andreessen says, be as big as the internet, or it's going to fail miserably. Now, if it fails, it'll likely be because something else better has emerged. I tend to think Bitcoin is the winner, but still very, very early days, I think.
So you're on the board of Stripe.
I'm actually not on the board. I'm an investor.
But you're an investor. I'm sorry.
Well, the board is Zoom, which is similar space.
But you're a participant in some of the up and coming financial companies. What's the thinking there in terms of whether to integrate with Bitcoin or not, or even like, you know, do you think PayPal will ever you know, have a sort of a way to exchange with Bitcoin? Why haven't we seen that already?
So Stripe has announced a Bitcoin integration for its merchants. Square announced a Bitcoin sort of integration with Square Market merchants. I suspect you'll see PayPal announce something. But I think most of those are sort of sideshows to like the main event. I don't think they're particularly like innovative or exciting, and they're using intermediaries like Coinbase. I mean, at the point right now, the infrastructure is pretty rudimentary. It's like sort of the first open source platform. You're gonna see lots of innovation around it that makes it usable. Similarly, there's only one bank in the United States that knowingly will process Bitcoin transactions. And so insofar as that's true, there's a lot of limits on the system. Now, as things become more clear and regulators take different positions, banks may be more comfortable, which allows like more innovation and more companies to work with them. I actually think, for example, this bank, I don't believe actually wants any more customers. Like, I think they have enough exposure to through startups to like the Bitcoin risk. So I think it's gonna be difficult to create whole new cloths, but people will experiment at the margins.
So we're New York-based, and one of the new things that I'm going to be doing in this new company I'm creating is building a digital currency exchange in New York. And we're actually working with a bunch of the big banks to do it and the regulators. And look, there's about a dozen banks that we're in conversations with right now. None of them want to be first, but they certainly don't want to be last or be left out. And I'm hopeful that we'll see over the next few months a few of them emerge as founding members of this exchange. But I am fairly confident that within the next few months, we're going to see Wall Street moving into Bitcoin in a pretty big way in terms of creating investment products, trading Bitcoin. I don't know what the catalyst was other than just CNBC doing way too many stories about Bitcoin, but Wall Street is getting very excited about this asset class, and I spend a lot of my time doing actually things like this. I mean, over the past couple weeks, I spoke at a Goldman conference and a Barclays conference and a high net worth conference, and if Wall Street moves into Bitcoin, if you see that money move in, it'll have I think a pretty positive effect on the consumer adoption side of things, because right now the monetary base of Bitcoin is about $6-7 billion. Daily trading volume is probably $100 million. You know, you're not going to see major merchants, brick and mortar bank or merchants accept Bitcoin if they're going to take a big loss on conversion every time they sell something. But if you increase the monetary base, you increase the volume and velocity in the exchanging of Bitcoin, it enables Bitcoin to fulfill its promise of being a fantastic payments platform, a remittance platform, and a money transfer platform, which is why I don't think you can kind of separate the two. I don't think you can have the best of Bitcoin without having a very, very large liquid currency as well.
So currencies are always based on trust. They're worth what people think they're worth. And you know, definitely this, you need some stability there in terms of just price fluctuation to get people to who aren't speculators or you know, who aren't early adopters.
Do you own Bitcoin?
I do not, no.
Why have you not bought Bitcoin yet?
It's been too difficult to even set up an account. I think I tried to set up an account at one point, but then I had to verify something with my bank account, and then I went off and did something else, and then I got an email that you know, showed that there was like a 74-cent deposit in the account, but then I had to log back in. I didn't really have time for it, and I don't really understand it that well. And then I had other things to do. We have this big conference that we've got to.
Well, so what's happening right now is, you know, we're in the middle of the VC phase getting involved in Bitcoin. And so over the past year, you've seen about 100, well, a new deal is being done right now, but there'll be about $125, $150 million will have been invested in about four or five companies. And all of these companies are dedicated towards making it easier to buy Bitcoin, to store Bitcoin, and to use Bitcoin. And all these companies, they're going to put on a marketing blitz, and they're going to put out fantastic products that will help solve this. But it'll take time. I suspect by this time next year, you'll be a Bitcoin owner.
So let's end with one big question, which is, what Bitcoin businesses are you excited about, or would you invest in? And I'm almost, I think that, you know, there's more than 100, maybe 160 Bitcoin companies on AngelList right now. Most of them are exchanges or wallets. Hopefully one of them will figure out the exchange and wallet part. Mm-hmm. But what's interesting to me is how do you sort of build on top of that? And maybe not even financial companies, but how do you use this technical innovation, this blockchain, this public ledger, and what can you build on top of that?
So I think I'm probably the most active angel investor already. I've invested in 25 Bitcoin companies, and so I was, you know, early in BitPay and Coinbase and Circle and Zappo and all those companies. And so there's a deal I'm doing right now to invest in a company called BitPesa. So BitPesa is a company based in Kenya that is connecting the M-Pesa network to enable the remittance of money coming from just three corridors, London, Boston, and New York, into Kenya. They're very, very focused on one remittance corridor, and if they're successful, they're going to then expand that throughout Africa.
So I guess I'd say I'm interested in two things. One would be infrastructure, which is infrastructure that's horizontal so that it unlocks these applications. It solves some of the core sort of deficiencies or challenges, and there are some people trying to do that. Those are complicated businesses. They tend to require a lot of capital. Second thing would be like a fairly significant combination of wallet and liquidity, so a viral wallet, for lack of a better term.
Okay. Well, great. Well, thanks for sharing your ideas with us. I hope you wear this T-shirt and you don't get accosted by any reporters.
Any reporters. Never get accosted by reporters.
And a big round of applause to our speakers.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.